I'm freaking out already, the fact that you guys filled the room. Can the guys in the back hear me?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Does the microphone help?
I talk very, I'm actually a very boisterous person. I talk very loudly when I'm in a room full of people, so I don't know how often I'll need this. If this becomes too cumbersome, I may drop it, so. But guys in the back, feel free to yell at me. You cannot hear me. It's okay. So again, thank you all so much for showing up. Can I have a hand of all my Final Fantasy cosplayers?
Wow.
Sweet. Make sure that you stick around the end of the panel because I have freebies to give away for all of you guys. Seriously, Danny?
Sorry!
Cell phones off. Thank you for doing Final Fantasy IX music.
You're welcome.
I was like,
I appreciate that immensely.
Okay.
So, my name is Valerie. I go by T5A Cosplay because I'm a cosplayer. Obviously, not in cosplay today. I left it at home. But hey, Final Fantasy VII shirt.
Yay!
Woo! I have actually been a huge fan of Final Fantasy since maybe 1990. I started out with the original Japanese game, and the fun story with that is I played every game from 1 to 14 in succession in the Japanese version. A friend of mine, father, used to go to Japan for businesses and such, and so he would always bring home the imports every couple of months, so that's how I started playing. And I have been a fan ever since then. And the reason I wanted to do this type of panel is because I'm a Final Fantasy nerd, but I've also was inspired by Akon's Fans Tract, which I don't know if you guys are aware of that, but it's basically anime academic style, and that's so up right up my alley. I'm in the process of finishing my third degree. It's focusing on film theory, but a lot of what I'm doing for the past couple semesters has been involved in digital storytelling and interactive media, which is perfect for video games. Hey, coincidentally. And I love Final Fantasy. How can you not love Final Fantasy? What? It's the best game series ever. Duh. Okay, so are there people here who do not know squat about Final Fantasy? Hey, we got one! Alright. Don't be shy, it's okay. I'm not gonna yell at you, seriously. So we got a couple of people here. And do I need to ask how many people love Final Fantasy?
Woo!
Starting out with a woo, I feel good already. So, I'm gonna have to do the obligatory panel thing, and I have to do the brief history of Final Fantasy. Those who know everything about the series, just bear with me for a moment. I'm trying to make it funny.
It's Final Fantasy. There's nothing brief about
it. There's nothing brief about it. I tried to make it brief. It's probably not going to be brief. So here's the abridged version. Hey! So start off with Final Fantasy I. It was released in 1987 for the Famicom. It was originally supposed to be the last game for Square Studios, but Sakaguchi-san, who was the original creator of the Final Fantasy series, wanted to give an RPG a shot and said, hey guys, let me just do this. He's been wanting to make an RPG for years for these guys. Finally had them say, okay, this is your last game. Go out with a bang. And it became this. It was lauded for its unique battle system, very engaging character creation, which even though it was limited for a Nintendo game, it was still pretty advanced for 1987. So, it says a lot. It's a very engaging storyline. They were going for D&D in console format. And the story of this one is four warriors of the crystal banded together to save the world. Yay! So Final Fantasy II happened because Final Fantasy obviously was not the Final Fantasy. This is considered the first story-intensive RPG for any console game. Before that, there really wasn't a whole lot of console games available that were very RPG-heavy. You had a couple on PC, not really for Nintendo or Atari or anything that was out there. Kids, there was this thing called the Atari in the 1980s. This is what I call it. Thank you! Yay, I got hands! Cool! So, if I say foreign words, I apologize in advance. It means I'm old.
Nah.
Yeah. So, part of the story with this one was a party of four banding together to stop the Emperor. It changed the experience point system to an ability leveling system.
Which was annoying.
A lot of the cool stuff that we got from Final Fantasy that we know and love so well are Chocobos, NPC interaction, and of course Cid, the master of everything. And then the fun fact I wanted to post on this one, in a Famitsu poll in 2013, for those who don't know what that is, it's a magazine in Japan who's like the uber god of all the gaming magazines. The Emperor was named as the best Final Fantasy villain.
Lies!
According to the Japanese.
Eyes!
I know Sephiroth is better. Final Fantasy III. Was not released until 2006. We actually never received it here in the States until it became a DS port and a PSP port. So for a lot of us, we haven't actually played Final Fantasy III. I did on my original Nintendo. It's a fun, fun game. And a lot of the original tropes of the series first originated in this game, such as the crazy colored hair, the big R swords, all the fun stuff like that. It streamlined a lot of the battle menus. It wasn't as D&D heavy and became more text heavy. And actually, I want to come over here. The picture that I have on the bottom is probably the best example of their battle menu. Previous Final Fantasy games, when you had the battle menu, it was basically here are your player characters, here's a giant line, and then here are your enemies. Now it all looks, it's moved like nothing, like water. It's like perfect, beautiful for a Nintendo game. Right. And the story is about four orphans who talk to Crystal, get his superpowers, and try to save the world. Okay. Final Fantasy IV, my personal favorite. Yeah. Originally released here in the United States as Final Fantasy II, but it's really Final Fantasy IV. What we really love about this game is they gave us ATV. I love ATV. Who loves
yes.
ATV?
Yes!
Best stuff ever! And we got to go to the moon. Yay! Awesome stuff. This is the first game that is considered the most character-oriented game, and it really drove RPGs into a brand new realm. It wasn't about the story, it was about these characters and their struggles and their journeys, and that's one of the reasons why I love it so much. It's just not happy-feely times, but you want to love the characters for all the wrong reasons.
No, it's happy-feely times.
And again, this happens in party numbers. But for the most part, you had four people throughout the game, and just kind of random visitors every now and then. Oh, they're trying to save the world, all that stuff. All right, Final Fantasy V was released in 1992 for the Super Famicom. By the way, that's the Super Nintendo. Final Fantasy V is probably one of the more wackier games in the history of the game franchise. It's got a very fun, really all I can say is a fun-loving story. It's one of those where you either love it or you hate it. That's all I can really say about it.
Awesome.
It is awesome. I personally enjoy it. I think it's a silly game. It's great. It gave us ability points, blue magic, and refined the active time battle system.
Woo-hoo. Yay!
And it took a lot of the elements of story and character development from past games and squished it into this one. This also had another four-party system where you're four warriors and a couple others that cycle in at times who try to save the world from being merged into two.
I thought there was a giant tree involved.
There's probably a tree involved. I don't know. The game is so wacky, I can't even describe it. So Final Fantasy VI is probably one of the best Super Nintendo games in the universe. If no other game ever compares to this except for maybe Chrono Trigger. Also a Squaresoft game. So one of the reasons that I love it so much is that it has one of the best soundtracks known to man, has a freaking opera in it, and the only villain that actually wins.
Yes! All hail Kafka!
But this is also one of the only games that really utilized Mode 7 with the Super Nintendo and transformed the graphics into something beautiful. And there's really no easy way for me to describe it. The only thing I can recommend is you guys go home, YouTube, Final Fantasy VI intro, that's all you need to put, 5 minutes and 30 seconds. It tells you everything you want to know about the game and how beautiful it is.
And if you're still not convinced, go look up the opera.
And there's still a four-party system, all that BS. Drink time, hey, honey. All right, Final Fantasy VII, which most of you are probably what got into the series. Yay or nay?
Yay!
Yay. There we go. So this was the game that sold PlayStation consoles. This was the one that moved systems. And I will admit that the reason I got a PlayStation was this sucker right here.
Amen.
Literally got it the day before this game released, so I had to make sure I got this game. So with FF6, before this game, it was more medieval setting, more European. This kind of propelled us more to like steampunk, cyberpunk, this weird little world that really didn't fit in with Final Fantasy all that well, and yet it seems to work seamlessly, not just because of, you know, chocobos and boogles and all that fun stuff, but just something about the stories and the characters compelled us to go, hey, this is a Final Fantasy game. So it's more menu-driven gameplay, improved ATB, spiky hair angst, weird blocky parts, we got a three-party system though, we change!
We went to a disc format, we changed our party system. Yay!
Yay!
It's also the first game outside of Final Fantasy I that retained its original number. So we had like Final Fantasy I, Final Fantasy II, which was really 4, Final Fantasy III, which was really 6, and then Final Fantasy VII came out, which confused the crap out of so many people. Final Fantasy VIII, of course.
Yay! Woo! Yeah!
Yeah! Yeah! Yeah!
Kick ass!
Whenever I talk about Final Fantasy VIII, people look at me like I'm crazy.
They're
you
crazy.
Are crazy!
Wow,
that's
crazy. Awesome. It's awesome, sweet.
Okay. Woo!
My people. So this one is a game that strives for a more thematic combination of fantasy and realism. They wanted the human characters to look as human as possible. Not so good in the world map mode, but hey, in the cutscenes, they were fabulous.
Amen.
Yeah.
So this is one of those games that, again, I think is a hit or miss with certain fans because it has time compression and, you know, time travel really never works.
It never
in a,
ends well.
In a video game unless it's Chrono Cross and Trigger. But fun fact is that this is one of the only soundtracks that would actually won awards. I mean, this is one of those video games where, hey, you can say, I play a game that has award-winning music.
Yay!
Also, one of the songs was featured in the 2002 Olympics. I just can't remember which one. They used it for the Spanish synchronized swimming team. I just can't remember which song it was. Enjoy that fact.
That's
pretty cool.
Oh yeah, and there was card games.
Woo! Card games!
My childhood.
And motorcycles. Just not together.
Damn it, Yu-Gi-Oh!
Considers this his favorite of all the Final Fantasy games. Anytime he wants to talk about a game, he will talk about this one. Because he feels like it combines the best of the best, everything that Final Fantasy has to offer. It takes the refinements of the storytelling with 3 and 5, the character building of 4 and 7 and 6, and it just gets this awesome mess of craziness. I love the game for the characters. That's really what stands out. How can you not love BB?
Thank you. That is adorableness.
So it still contains a 3-party system. Hey, you have active time events, which really hasn't been utilized in future games, but this was kind of a cool feature for those who don't know what it is. Active time events basically means that you could be watching one scene, you could push a button and move to another character who would be interacting with a different scene, and you get different dialogue sequences. That was kind of cool. It was nifty. I don't know why they don't keep doing that. And then there's this ugly thing called Play Online, which they moved it to Final Fantasy XI, which is better. Alright, Final Fantasy X. This is probably what got you into Final Fantasy was 10. I mean, how can you not like 10? It's the first entry into PlayStation 2. Not quite the system seller that 7 was, but I think a lot of us can say that we wanted a PS2 because of 10.
Yeah.
It was one of the first Final Fantasies to use full 3D backgrounds. So you actually had a completely immersive experience. You had voice acting, and you had real-time storytelling. Voice acting was questionable on the English side, but that's okay. John DiMaggio was one of the voice actors, and you cannot say anything bad about Bender. That's totally fine. It also was the first game that removed the foreign feel. So you had more of, in previous Final Fantasies, you had the medieval stuff, I mean, you got the cyberpunk stuff, but this is one where you actually had more traditional Asian styles with the architecture and the clothing, even in some of the dialogue. So that was kind of different from Final Fantasy. And of course, it was the very first game to spawn a spin-off. There's the spin-off. I like 10-2 because it is campy, and it's not ashamed of making itself campy. So, there you go.
The job system was awesome.
Great job system, too. All right, Final Fantasy XI, this is the personal favorite.
Only one.
The one. The guy that I'm with is the one who says yes to it.
I like the
job. It is the first online game for any Final Fantasy, and the one thing that I really adore about this is that it was the first MMO that was solely focused on trying to make it a cross-platform experience. So if you had a PlayStation 2, you could play with somebody who had a 360, or if you could play with someone who had a PC, you could all be on the same server, you could all speak in the same language.
And all the PS2 users could be miserable.
Exactly. So that's the one thing I really admire about this game, and it did go back to the medieval style again. It brought in more of a D&D feel, especially with, you know, you had orcs, you had goblins, you had elves this time, finally, so
I'm a personal big fan of Final Fantasy XI, but I also played it for like 7 years, so
yeah.
Final Fantasy XII moves back to more story-centric This is probably one of the more heavily story-centric games, and it's so politically involved. It's one of the games that I would say play two or three times to understand what the crap is going on. Oh my goodness. There's so many little side things. If you just do the main plot, you're not going to get everything. You have to do all the side quests because you're going to get lost. As always, new shiny lovely system. I actually like the gambit system because it could be really easy or stupidly complicated. You might know what you want to do.
Yeah.
We had some draw, shiny graphic upgrade, and it's also the first prequel for a Final Fantasy main title, which was Final Fantasy Tactics.
Really?
Yes.
Best game ever. Speaking of, here are the other Final Fantasy games that kind of happened. There's a lot of spin-offs in the Final Fantasy franchise. For the purpose of this panel, I'm only focusing on 1 through 13, because 14 is still kind of under development with expansion packs and whatnot. Yes, they have to do 13. It's part of the franchise. Hush. Heckler.
You love me for it.
So, for the purpose of this panel, because I could do an entire section literally on 10-2, as crazy as that sounds, the mythology in 10-2 is absolutely insane, and there's just not enough time to do that. And I'm trying to keep this basic as much as possible. The water did not appreciate the microphone. So those games happened, and then there's Final Fantasy 13 that also happened. Next slide. Thank you! Controversial games, according to fans, because this is really a love-hate relationship.
This is
one of those games where it was intentionally developed to have a story arc that went over multiple titles. So that was the intent behind this entire game. It's not like 10-2 or even Final Fantasy IV the after years, where the sequel just kind of magically happened afterwards. No, this game was with the mind of, okay, we're going to have sequels to it. It was also the first Final Fantasy to release on multiple platforms at the same time, which got everybody into fits and, oh my goodness, you're not on the PlayStation 3 only? What's wrong with you?
For shame.
Final Fantasy 14 is the second MMO in the RPG franchise for Final Fantasy. However, I think we can probably say this is the one Final Fantasy that failed miserably at release. But, in Square's credit, they have done an awesome job in remaking it. They released it in 2013, and I've been told it's a very magnificent game. I haven't had time to play it like I want to, and it makes me very sad.
It's gorgeous. Awesome.
It's very good.
It's gorgeous.
I'm also a cosplayer, so I don't have all the free time in the world. I sew a lot. So, this is one of those games where it takes... let me start it this way. I played the original version back in 2010. It was, The one thing I appreciated, though, is that it kept with the classic Final Fantasy feel. And you have to play with jobs a lot. And in fact, you could switch jobs whenever you wanted to. There was no restrictions. That was fantastic. As of 2013, it's really a game for fans by fans. Because there are so many in-jokes that would just make any Final Fantasy fangirl squeal.
It does, actually.
And then there are things to come in the future.
Yay!
That's about 27 years of Final Fantasy. I have no idea how long that took me. And I know. Hey, that wasn't too bad. Could have been worse.
Yeah, it could have been.
I could have
kept the other five pages.
Worse.
You could have kept the other five pages.
Okay. All right, so moving on. Does everybody have a general idea what Final Fantasy is now? If you have no idea what Final Fantasy is. It's an RPG. There you go. But one of the reasons that I wanted to talk about it so much is without Final Fantasy, we wouldn't have so many of the RPGs that we have today. We wouldn't have so many of the battle systems we have today. We wouldn't have even the random monster encounters. The concept wasn't refined until Final Fantasy came along. And at the same time, Final Fantasy also pushed forward so many cool new ideas for different types of video games, like action-adventure games. I mean, there are certain things in Borderlands even that you could point out and say, yeah, this wouldn't have happened without Final Fantasy. Even certain concepts like leveling systems, I mean, come on. Experience points, yeah, you could say D&D did this, Ultima Online did some of this, but really without Final Fantasy, it wouldn't have been as popular. Particularly back in the early Nintendo days, back when Final Fantasy was originally released, not many RPGs were out there on the market. You had the original Dragon Quest.
This is Dragon Quest.
Yeah, the original Dragon Quest is probably the first one, and that one
had a single player and it was more story driven and very, very short game. Didn't have the same features that Final Fantasy had. It wasn't until this series came along that Dragon Quest updated itself and was like, okay, we can add more characters, we can quadruple our storyline and have more content in
it. We can make this work.
Yeah, we can make all these wonderful things work. Okay, so one of the aspects I have really appreciated from Final Fantasy from the very, very beginning is its ability to take the history and the cultures of so many other places, deconstruct it, and turn it into their own story. I've always thought that was the coolest thing in the universe. And things that even we are aware of, I mean, we talk about Shiva and we probably think immediately Final Fantasy. We don't think about the Hindu god of destruction. The same with Bahamut. We immediately think of Final Fantasy as a crazy-ass dragon. Actually, Bahamut is a fish in Arabic legends who actually carries the world on his back. That's what he does. So Bahamut's actually a giant fish. He's a dragon now, that's fine.
Megaflare for the win.
Yeah, exactly. And if it's not summons or spells, it's names of towns, it's certain job abilities, it's character names. It just pulls from so many different resources that you can't help but love it. And this is the one quote that I'm going to read. I don't like to read from my PowerPoint slides. I try to make it like bullet point stuff, but this is a quote that I want to read so badly. Okay, so this came from Yusuke Nara, who is the art director for 7, 8, and 10 for all of the 7 games. There will always be summons and chocobos, but we do it as homage to our past and mark the things that make Final Fantasy great, that make the world great. And I think that's a really cool way of looking at it. That's why they take all of these cultures and mythologies and squish it into what Final Fantasy is all about. All right, so now we're gonna talk about some of the mythologies that Final Fantasy uses. I'm a Star Wars nerd, so we're in Star Wars slide. Yay! It's appropriate, I promise.
On shot first.
By the way, guys, if you have any questions, if you want to throw out anything, you are more than welcome to. Just raise your hand and I will point to you. So don't feel shy or afraid. I know there's a lot of people in here. But feel free to do so. So, the Star Wars slide. For me, it became very obvious from a very young age that a lot of the things that Final Fantasy uses come from Star Wars. And Star Wars actually pulls from other cultures too, so it kind of makes sense. Sakaguchi-san is unabashedly a huge Star Wars nerd. He's not afraid to say so. He loves his Star Wars, and there's a lot of people on the development team who adore Star Wars too, so it's no surprise. You'll find a lot of Easter eggs in the game. Like, most people will know Final Fantasy VII has Biggs and Wedge.
Amen.
Yeah. And an 8. I mean, everybody knows who Biggs and Wedge is. So.
14 also.
14, and 14 has it too?
Yes. Yeah. They're engineers working for Sid.
Why am I not surprised by this? Damn it, Biggs. But there's other little fun things too. Like, if you look at every single Final Fantasy game, there is actually a little silhouette of Darth Vader somewhere.
Every single one.
Every single Final Fantasy game. My favorite one, this is probably the easiest one to find, is if you go through Final Fantasy VII, you are as Cloud, Barrett, and Tifa, and you're in the process of scaling the wall to get to Shinra headquarters. Uh-huh. It's the wall that has the graffiti on it that says, like, no mercy on it.
Uh-huh.
There's that one point where you're jumping that swinging pipe, there's a small Vader in the background.
God help us for that swinging pipe.
Yeah, I didn't want to try to find a picture of it because it was going to take me too long, so I have enough to worry about. So, but there's a lot of Easter eggs like that in the game. But at the same time, they've also developed a lot of their story around some of the concepts that Star Wars utilize. My favorite one is the Darth Vader clone, which obviously means somebody who's a lot like Darth Vader. Hey, obviousness. So this archetype is the anti-villain of Darth Vader, which basically means he started out with good intentions, but then something happened to him. He had a traumatic life event where he changed. He became dark, and he became subservient to some other master.
Yay,
he
serves mind control.
That master. Yeah, it's basically mind control in its own weird way. He becomes subservient to that master, and at one point throughout the story, the person finds out that what he's doing is really wrong. He still has good in him, and then he changes at the end to become good. And in doing so, he dies like Darth Vader. Sorry if I spoiled Star Wars for anybody. I've ruined everything for everybody. So, probably the most obvious one would be Golbez from Final Fantasy IV, who was all big, dark, and broody. He even has the epic cape to go with it. and the helmet. So, and he also has, this is what I thought was hilarious when they finally put voices to Final Fantasy IV for the DS release. He's got a very gravelly voice. It's almost like he's got a breathing tube or something.
I did not think of it that way.
It's just kind of creepy. You're like, okay, why are they making him sound like Vader now? Okay. You also have Gabranth from Final Fantasy XII. Then you have Leon from Final Fantasy II. And there's one guy from 14. I cannot pronounce his name. It's like Gaius von Valseer.
That's it.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay, so I'm gonna keep going with the Final Fantasy IV theme because Final Fantasy IV and Star Wars share a lot of stuff together.
Yeah,
they shared a ton of stuff, and it's not little things. Like originally, one of the ships that you steal in the game is called the Falcon. In the Japanese release, it was originally M. Falcon from Millennium Falcon. Yeah. However, when they dubbed things over to English translation, they ran out of characters, so they had to chop them down.
Nice.
Yay! But the one that I really like the most is when Cecil is good. I call him Cecil. I know it's Cecil. It's Cecil. I don't care. Cecil goes through his paladin training, much like the same way that Luke goes through the trials on Dagobah.
Yeah, except
with Luke Yoda. Failed. Yeah, so I mean, even though there's a little bit of a difference where Cecil wins, and you win by not fighting your Dark Knight self, in essence, it's doing exactly the same thing as Luke was trying to do by not fighting against Vader in order to find that he was on the light side. Instead, we find that Luke is wavering on both sides.
Yay, expanded universe!
Exactly. And then Golbez, of course, who is Darth Vader in all types of ways. When he initially reveals himself to be Cecil's brother, sorry, spoiler alert, it's in very much the same manner, and even the way that the scene is set up is very reminiscent of The Empire Strikes Back when Vader goes, Luke, I'm your father.
No!
Yeah, exactly. It's like, Cecil, I'm your brother. Again, spoiler alert, I'm sorry. Spoilers! He also ends up turning good at the end, when you think about it. He follows this trope of Darth Vader almost to a T, because he turns good at the end and sacrifices himself so he can help the hero to beat Zemus. However you want to pronounce his name. Japanese are crazy like that. But even when he does that towards the end, how is that not like Darth Vader? It's totally like Darth Vader.
He doesn't die, if that helps.
Yeah, he really doesn't die. No. Meh.
Meh.
Another thing that I'm not going to have time to get into, though I would love to get into, and this is another thing that I recommend you guys Google, Final Fantasy XII in Star Wars. There are a ton of papers, like actual academic papers on this stuff, that go into how Final Fantasy XII is so much like Star Wars, and it goes from like the characters, and which is why I have Final Fantasy XII in the bottom quarter, where you know, Han and Chewie are all there and Fran. I'm not saying Fran is Chewy, because Fran is too pretty to be Chewy. But seriously though, go look at it. Even under all of the political drama that's going on, it really goes down to the basic core of the story, saying, you know, here's the Empire, here are the rebels. And
kick your ass.
Also other random Star Wars stuff. Final Fantasy VII, Maneki is an anagram for mannequin.
Yeah. Oh, that picture's cute.
Isn't that cute? I think it's adorable. As creepy as it is.
Oh, it's completely creepy, but it's adorable too.
So, of course, I have to talk a little bit about religion in this panel, and I want to start out by saying that I'm not decreeing or decrying or saying anything bad about anybody's religious choices, whatever floats your boat, cool beans. I'm actually going to be mostly focusing on religions that are now considered myths, religions that were once practiced by even by the Greeks and the Romans many, many years ago before any of us could even imagine what a video game was possibly about. So, speech over.
Yay!
Okay, so Final Fantasy VII is a giant smorgasbord to all things religion. The game was initially developed when Sakaguchi-san's mother passed away. So he dove into a lot of religious texts trying to figure out how to cope with it, and Final Fantasy VII was born from it. He especially focused on Marian Kabbalah, which is a form of Gnosticism in Jewish texts, which basically says that the Gnostics are kind of like the ancients, where the ancients know the true meaning of the world. Hey, that's an awesome thing too. I point out ringtones, I'm sorry. But that the ancients know the true meaning of the world and how the world is supposed to be, and everybody else around them is just crazy and doesn't understand what's going on. And in many ways, a lot of other religions, what's a good word for this? I don't want to say kickback. What's the word that I'm thinking of? I can't think of the word. I'm terrible at this. Persecute. There we go. The Gnostics were persecuted for their beliefs, much like the ancients were persecuted for their beliefs. A lot of people thought that the Gnostics were being crazy. What do you mean being able to talk to the planet and living for the planet and all this craziness and what the heck are you meaning? The Hojo's reunion theory, the idea that entities infused with Genova cells would one day be able to, you know, become the Holy One and be God and all that fun stuff. Gnosticism actually has a concept that's very similar to that. They call it, let's see, it's a form of the absolute and something else, and I'm not going to try to pronounce the word because it's in Hebrew, and I'm too white to be doing that. But it's the idea that every human is born with a fragment of God, and once they die, they will end up returning to God, aka the life stream, in very much a similar manner. And in fact, the way the life stream is described in Final Fantasy VII is eerily similar to the absolute. The only difference is that the absolute stems from a tree.
Oh wait, so we're back to Final Fantasy
IX. I know, so trees make a really big deal in most of the Final Fantasy games, so it actually kind of makes sense, yeah. I mean, it kind of makes sense, but in the way that it's described, it's really, really similar, and it's kind of creepy. Okay, so we have Genova, which you could easily derive as Jehovah or Yahweh, God, hey. And then you have Sephiroth, hey. Its Hebrew meaning is counting or enumeration. And if you think about Sephiroth's clones, he had 10 clones in the game. He technically had 12, but only 10 of them are named. 8 of them are actually counted out in numbers in the game, and then you had Cloud and Zack as 9 and 10, and there's 10 of them, and there's apparently 10 levels of Yahweh in there, Kabbalah. It all makes sense! Yay! Good stuff. Meteor is also a fun one because we know what Meteor is. Meteor is there for Sephiroth to summon to the planet, destroy all things so he can ascend to godlihood. There's something in the Zohar, which is also a part of Kabbalah, where you take the Tree of Life, and if you destroy it, it'll actually grant you godlike powers in the similar way that Meteor is done. You have to call upon this heavenly force to come down and destroy the tree in order to be like God.
Yay!
Is it creepy and kind of weird how it's so oriented in religion? And then you have other things like, you know, the Promised Land is totally... The ancients' walk to the Promised Land is very much like a retelling of Moses leaving Hebrew and the Israelites. I mean...
Leaving Hebrew?
Yeah.
The word is Egypt, honey.
Yeah. Shush, I don't care. I'm tired. It's already Friday. And this is just the surface of everything. I mean, there is so much going on. Like, just Norse mythology alone will make your head break. There's just an insane amount of Norse mythology in Final Fantasy VII that I can't even get on. Alright. So, Final Fantasy X obviously talks about a lot of religion. We know this. It's fakey, made-up religion, but a lot of people believe that... the Order of Yevon is more like Catholicism, and that Yuna and her ragtag group of friends are more like the Gnostics because of their beliefs. And when you start breaking it down, it kind of makes sense, because the Order of Yevon, particularly at its height, was kind of pushy. They didn't like people believing other things. They wanted everybody to kind of be on their side. You think of like the Spanish Inquisition, that's why. Spanish Inquisition joke in there, totally. Or I start bringing out into a song. But if you think about the way the Order of Yevon is, it's very much like a hierarchy. I mean, the maesters are cardinals, basically. And then when you get to Yomika, who is the topest, highest priest involved, especially later on in the game, he actually starts taking on the form of the Pope, like he gets like a Pope habit and everything. Seriously, if you start replaying the game again, this is how he initially comes out, but as you start replaying the game, you'll find that his clothes start changing, and he starts looking more and more like the Pope. It's really funny.
It all makes sense.
It makes a whole lot of sense. It is ridiculous how much it is. Let's see. Oh, Gnostic text. Okay, let's do this one. So, the fireflies. Yes, fireflies. Fireflies are a fun one.
Sparkly!
The Gnostic text, the fireflies and the far plane are very similar to something that's also in Japanese text, where In Final Fantasy X, we know that the Pyreflies are basically the souls of the dead who are kind of wandering and looking for peace, right?
Yeah.
Exactly, and they want to go to the Far Plane. The Far Plane is like heaven, happy place, woohoo. There's something similar to that in Gnosticism as well as in Shintoism, which is Japanese religion and mythology, where the Fireflies actually represent dead souls who are trying to seek a way to the afterlife. If everybody has seen the movie Grave of the Fireflies, it plays very heavily on that. I'm sorry. I heard the odds. I'm sorry. I thought about putting a picture up here, and I was like, that would be a bad idea. And just to keep going with the Catholicism thing, hey, for all Christianity, there's a guy named Titus in the game. I think his name is Titus.
Yay!
So we have this physical manifestation of sin in the game. He's kind of big and ugly and honking. And then we have this guy named Titus who pops up out of nowhere. He kind of rises from the dead, so to speak, to go and fight for our sins. And then he dies for our sins.
He dies fighting our sins?
I am not going to make the direct connection that he may be somebody named Jesus, but I think it's pretty obvious that he kind of is. So the thing that I like about Final Fantasy is it brings in multiple religious texts. Usually it goes by Gnosticism because it's so out there and spiritual. It's very easy to manipulate into a fantasy realm. But at the same time, they're not doing it to be like, oh, this religion's bad, this religion's bad, because they actually pull in some good stuff from Christianity. I mean, Final Fantasy X is a great example of this. It's like, yeah, Catholicism might be harsh on some people, but they still have good ideas, and they make great stories. I mean, the story of Jesus is kind of a compelling story. Even if you don't believe in it, it's kind of a cool story to listen to. Why not remake it into a video game?
The ritual sacrifice was a bit much.
It is a bit much. Okay. So, because I didn't have enough time for this, if I have time at the end, I actually want to do, like, individual summons and stuff and go through their mythology. Like, I have one for the, I think I have one for Ragnarok, actually.
Yeah, one for the Doom Train?
I tried to find stuff on Doom Train, but it's not so I think they made it up.
Yeah.
Well, there are not many things that Final Fantasy actually made up other than, like, Chocobos, Tomaries, Cactars, and Moogles. By the way, Moogles are Ewoks.
Far more awesome.
Far more, yeah. So, I mean, it's really hard to find certain things. But I actually found stuff on Carbuncle. Most people don't think that he's actually a real mythological being, but he is. So, but if we have time at the end, I'll go over it. So I have to quickly go through mythology, the mythos that Final Fantasy has created. So this is probably going to dance more along trope territory, because at this point, because Final Fantasy has been around so long, there are so many things that this game does that just seem silly and very trope-worthy. Black Mage, Red Mage, White Mage, for example, didn't really exist until Final Fantasy came along, and now everybody uses it.
Yes.
Yeah.
You can say Healer, DPS, and all that stuff, but really it's White Mage, Black Mage. Let's be honest here. So a lot of what we see in Final Fantasy, let me start that over again, a lot of what we see in video games today actually originated from Final Fantasy. As I pointed out earlier, Borderlands was my prime example. And actually, I'm going to flip over to the next slide. Like, this is a good trope one. Insanely high level caps. This is crap did not exist until Final Fantasy came out.
Oh, God.
Like, level 99 has got nothing on these guys. This
holy
is
crap.
Don't ask me about Guardians Crusade, I think. I think it's level 50, and that was high enough for me.
Who would do that?
People would do that. Who goes to level 99 in Final Fantasy? Thank you.
Hey, there's Secret Boss's murder.
I used to have a 200 in the PSO.
See, there you go.
That's insane.
But there are other funny little tropes that also kind of started.
Yes.
We Final Fantasy and have thus expanded since then. Costume porn is basically a nice way of saying it's you can't describe the costume. It is so elaborate, so magnificent, so crazy that it really cannot be described. And they've been doing this since Final Fantasy II. I've been, you know.
Lil, thanks to you for that.
Yeah, I have been very much susceptible.
Oh, gosh! Oh, God!
But the reason I bring all of this up is because other video game developers have learned from Final Fantasy. They are fans of Final Fantasy, and they do the same thing. Castlevania is a fantastic prime example of this. I mean, that artwork alone is like, monoed up like crazy.
No kidding.
That one is beautiful, gorgeous artwork. Pokemon Diamond and Pearl Team Galactic is inspired by Final Fantasy. The developer who originally made the team was like, I like Final Fantasy and I wanted to do some of their costumes. So there you go. Assassin's Creed 2, also one of the developers for the Renaissance period costuming, she had initially said that she was really inspired by some of the flow and the movement of the fabrics in the Final Fantasy series, particularly with 9 and 10. So, there we go.
Fair enough. Cool.
Oh yeah, and this is because I have to do Amano's. This is actually Amano's artwork, so.
Nice.
He feminized Darth Vader. There we go. Feminized androgynous. Whatever. So yes, I've already talked about white mage, black mage, red mage. But other funny tropes are like the big flipping swords. As obvious by Tina there in the corner, you got my sword is better than your gun, which is totally overkill for Final Fantasy 11. The gun sucks in 11. One winged angel, which is the trope, the Emperor's Final Fantasy VII, of course, and that one is where your final boss at the end of the game starts out as a normal being, but then grows into a super powerful being, and then grows even further after that to a point of ridiculous proportions, and you're like, why am I still fighting this guy? This has been 25 minutes.
And he's got his own theme music!
He's got his own theme music. Here's the thing, is that this is not the first time it's happened in a Final Fantasy game. It starts only in Final Fantasy 1.
Yeah, it does.
It's really heavily abused in Final Fantasy 3 when you go through Cloud of Darkness. So it is not just a 7 theme, it is an everything thing. Okay. And I wanted to talk a little bit more about some of the story elements that have now become mythology. Where friendship overcomes all odds. Aw.
Friendship is magic!
No. So unlike a lot of other RPGs, particularly when they first started out, Final Fantasy was one of those that actually thrived on the idea that you needed a party in order to accomplish your goal. You need to have your friends. You can't do anything by yourself. The few missions where you try to do something by yourself are either ridiculously hard or they're intentionally set up to make you fail. So that way your party members can come in and save you.
Yeah.
And it seems so commonplace now, because we play video games and we're like, okay, yeah, that makes sense. You know, you either have a first-person shooter, you're a soloer, or you get a party, done. But back then it was so revolutionary, people didn't realize, oh hey, we can have more than one person on the screen and it can mean something to the story and the characters. So there you go. Duality and cycles. Particularly in Final Fantasy, it means that evil can never be truly destroyed. There must be a balance of yin and yang. Yin and yang must always exist in a Final Fantasy game. And it can be anything from like having two different worlds. You have lightness and darkness, like you have in Final Fantasy 3 and 13 and 13.2. You literally have two physical worlds. You have Cocoon and the other place. I tolerate Final Fantasy 13, so.
Barely tolerate.
I tolerate it. Let's see. Oh yeah, in the Final Fantasy V, because I kind of touched on this a little bit earlier, the actual physical world of Final Fantasy V is split into two, and there are crystals on each one. And that's the balance of the game, is being able to keep those two worlds separate. The evil guy in that game wants to crush the two together to cause darkness to happen.
Squish!
Everything would return to the void at that point. So the heroes are trying to keep the worlds apart in order to maintain that yin-yang balance. So very heavily, heavily used in Final Fantasy V. And then heroic sacrifice, which is why I have a lot of Final Fantasy IV pictures up there, because that happens a lot in the game.
Oh god.
I'm going to talk about Final Fantasy IV in a very deeply emotional way right now, because Final Fantasy IV is my favorite game, and this is what solidified my love for the franchise. Because a lot of the game deals with overcoming impossible odds, trying to find yourself, and a lot of your friends dying in the process. Okay, I say the word dying with quotes, because a lot of them don't really die. They like phase out, they get frozen in time, stuff like that happens. A couple people do actually die. It's kind of sad. And this happened a lot in Final Fantasy games. Oh my god. So many games. I'll just say 7.
I was about to ask where the most obvious picture was.
The most obvious one is 7. I have to go through this one. I have to read off this because this is ridiculous. So,
With Final Fantasy IV is the fourth game in the series, and Final Fantasy had this weird thing about numbers, particularly threes and fours. As you notice, as I was saying throughout the beginning of the panel, four party members, it moved to three party members, usually four crystals, three crystals, three whatever. Four and three is a big number for Final Fantasy. Four in particular, usually the fourth party member in any of the Final Fantasy games is going to have a heroic sacrifice for dice. Yeah, so just be prepared for that. If you want to get attached to somebody, don't do it to the fourth character. Final Fantasy VII, Aerith, Aerith, however you want to say her name, she was the fourth person to join your party.
Oh.
Holy crap!
She was destined to die.
God,
I am sorry. When it comes to Final Fantasy XII, you do have a lot of party members that come and go. Your very first party member in in Final Fantasy XII, who's really cool. His name is Fassler. He's an awesome guy. He had these great limit attacks, and then he dies. It happens so often, and Final Fantasy IV is probably the biggest abuser of this trope in so many ways. And the fact that it's also the fourth game in the franchise was just doomed for people to die. You spend most of the game in a four-person party, but ultimately that fourth person ends up leaving somehow and gets cycled in with a new person every single time. It's depressing, especially when you're 6 years old.
God, yes.
So the deal with the numbers, I tried to find some history and some research into this because there's really nothing that's like, okay, number three and number four, what does that mean in other cultures? Diddly and squat. I mean, we can say like the triple sixes work in certain cultures, even like lucky number seven, or you know, 13 is the evil number. What the heck do three and four look? And I had people raise their hands. Sweet. Go.
Well, in Chinese and Japanese, the number four is associated with death, which is why in hospitals, there's no fourth floor, because it sounds like death, like shit, it sounds like death. Like, it's, That's why.
There it is.
Yeah.
You totally took my point away. But thank you. That's awesome that you know that. I saw another hand over here. But
I got it.
Cool. The wavelengths. They're working. But cool. I'm glad that you said that, though. But there was one quote that I wanted to pull in. One of the core elements of the games I designed, and this is from Sakaguchi-san directly, is simplicity. There are other important story issues such as life, death, love, all complicated things, but I like to build the game from a simple beginning, a number or a color, and branch out from there. And he said that in a Japanese newspaper in 2001. So even he, from the very beginning, was like, we need to keep it as simple as possible and branch out from there, and you get the craziness that's going on with like 13, 14, and 15. So yeah. And hey, that makes my panel so much easier. Wow, I flew this a lot faster than I expected, guys. I seriously had like a 30-page presentation going on.
She did. She was cutting it last night.
Cutting it down so much these past couple of weeks. It has been absolutely insane. So I'm just glad that I got this far. Yay for that. So I'm surprisingly done faster than I anticipated. So let's do this. I'm going to open up the floor to you guys. If there's anything that you wanted to talk about, if there's anything you want to throw in there, otherwise I'll pull out my papers and we can start talking about other summons.
I'm like,
summons!
Hang on, I got a couple of paper with me.
Since he's up there, is that a name, monkey tail or cat tail?
Monkey.
I vote monkey, just the thing that you can do with the
monkey tail.
That deck did not come out. I am sorry. PG room, I promise.
He's Kid Goku, it's fine.
Yeah.
He's Kid Goku in Final Fantasy IX.
We'll take it.
Sure.
Minus the giant monkey form.
Ooh, okay, I'm gonna do this one, because this one, people give me so much flack for liking the summon, the Mega Sisters.
Yes! Yes!
They're in Final Fantasy X, and they originally appear in Final Fantasy IV as the bad guys. They also come up in Final Fantasy XI as another variation in the form of the Mithras and the three cat ladies that are NPCs. But I love the Mega Sisters. I think they have the coolest attack in Final Fantasy X. I abused the crap out of them. Nobody likes them.
It's the costumes!
It's the costume. They're these weird
bug
things. But they're so cool. So you look at something like that and you probably think, okay, wait, there is no
no possible way that this thing has any mythological origin. This has got to be an original Final Fantasy character. I dug and dug and dug, and I wanted to be absolutely certain that this thing was a Final Fantasy thing. I found something on it. So, there's this thing called Zoroastrian. I'm going to spell this out because I probably botched this pronunciation of this.
No, it's correct.
Did I?
Yes.
I am awesome with languages.
Go back!
It's an ancient Iranian religion. Basically, there's a story called the Three Sisters Gardens. See, there's these three sisters who are having trouble trying to till the land and make their crops grow. They kept having these three separate plots and nothing was working. They decided, why don't we come together, squish all these crops, and maybe we can get something working. And lo and behold, through some magical greatness of the universe, they were able to get the crops to grow. People thought it was an amazing thing, and they were dubbed as the Vega Sisters from there on out. Oddly, the fun thing is the plants were corn, bean, and squash. And if you think about the Mega Sisters, you got a corn, you got a bean, and then you got a squash. And the thought that their bees are kind of like this, almost Gaijinka human form of pollination, if you think about it. Because, right. You know, insects and such help plants grow, as icky and gross as they are. Some of them do help grow plants. So, hey. It makes sense. I just thought it was really cool that there was actually mythology on these guys. I didn't think that existed anywhere. I thought it was cool.
I'm still saying no to those costumes.
That's fine. I still think they're cool, so hey. And honestly, that's all I had. That's the coolest one I have. The rest of them are going to take me way longer than the 10 minutes that we have left to go over. So.
Do some of the rarer summons.
I don't have all that stuff.
You didn't bring it?
No, I don't have all this stuff.
Okay then.
So I'm gonna come up here. Hi, people.
Somebody say something!
Here.
What's your thoughts on the Squall of the Dead theory?
Oh, here we go.
Yeah.
I'm an optimist. I wanna say that he's still alive. However, the whole time compression thing is so jacked up. I mean, it can go a million ways to Sunday.
There's a lot of evidence that makes it believable that he might be dead.
It just kind of goes into this weird myriad of things. And actually somebody pointed me to this weird blog post where they had started out from the very beginning saying that, hey, after Squall died at the very beginning of the game, this is him having mass delusions before he dies at the end.
Where would he have died at the beginning of the game?
Yes. When he's had that fight with Cypher.
It wasn't that deep of a head wound!
I know.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's possible too. You had your hand raised.
I haven't heard this theory, and Age is my favorite game, so I'm very interested.
Do you want to describe the theory? Because I know like 20 different variations of this theory.
The main theory is that when Squall goes from front of the end, she stabs him with the ice, it kills him. And then he's basically going through the EMT drug that you experience, that your brain, the chemical, your brain goes when you're dying.
It's basically you have these hallucinations and illusions for the rest of it. Okay,
yeah.
That's the one that you're thinking of. Because there's another one that I know of that happens more towards the end of the game, where Ultimecia and the weird time compression stuff just...
mess.
I love Final Fantasy VIII, but the time compression thing, just don't do time travel in a game, please.
Well,
it's confusing. I'm my own grandpa, seriously. Seriously. See, I think you had your hand up. Yes. Did you?
I don't remember what it was.
That's not a problem. Yes, you, the ghost.
So in Final Fantasy VII, there was Kat Sith, which is actually pronounced Kenshi.
Yes.
Do you want to elaborate on that? I've heard so many variations on the mythology of Kenshi and creating all the different cat demons throughout the game. Do you want to elaborate on any of that? You know, the Kenshi legend at all?
You know what, I don't know a whole lot about the legend. I wanted to research more into it, but I thought I would do more of like the fun, unique stuff that no one's really heard of before. I think a lot of people know who Kate Sith is and have a general idea, which is why I stayed away from like Shiva and Bahama and Rabba and Titan and all that stuff, because seriously, who doesn't learn about that in general mythology classes? That's the only reason why I didn't want to go over it. But this is what I'm actually going to do. After this panel is over with, I'm going to upload the entire thing to my blog and to my website and to our podcasting page, CosPod. I'm also going to have like a run-through of the panel. I can add that to it. So there we go. Done. Yes.
Just which mythology is Carbuncle from?
Shoot.
And now you can.
I gotta think now. It's not Greek. It's not Hebrew. It's not Iranian. It's not Norwegian. Shoot.
Wasn't Arabian, was it?
It's Arabian.
Sweet!
And incidentally enough, it's a very similar concept to the way carbuncle is. It's this green monster with the red jewel on its head that's supposed to have healing powers. And that's basically about it. It doesn't get very descriptive in all of my research. By the way, if you Google carbuncle, please put Final Fantasy afterwards, because there's an actual skin thing that's called carbuncle. Those are nasty images. Stay away. You'll find things you cannot unsee. Yes.
What do you think of the theory that Shinra from Final Fantasy X-2 actually went to the world of Final Fantasy VII years before it actually happened and started the Shinra Corp?
I say BS.
Actually, that was confirmed from one of the developers.
Who?
I don't know.
I want a name so I can ask him, because there's only...
Confirmation by developer.
I want to actually... I wonder if it's a new developer, because a lot of the old developers wouldn't have done that. I want to Google that because that seems kind of cool. It's really the only character who has been blatant about going in every game has been like Gilgamesh.
Oh,
Gilgamesh is one of those characters who's actually said, yeah, I've been to this world. And he confirms it in Dissidia too. I mean, he's like, hey, I've been to all of these places. I know they exist. So.
And he still sucks.
Yeah, why am I not surprised? Gilgamesh is free. Where at? I see one over there, so I'll do it first.
So, Final Fantasy VI had one of the largest variety of characters.
Yes.
If you go through the storyline for those characters, each character has its own story except for Gogo.
Mm-hmm.
Are there any like background things for Gogo that you've been able to find that are like,
the Emperor theory?
What the hell is up with this mind?
Honestly, I'm going to tell you to Google it because there's a lot of content for him. Make sure you don't look for fan fiction, though. That's the tricky part.
That never
Gogo goes into some weird fan fiction territory that, again, you cannot unsee. There is a lot of really good content out there on what people believe Gogo came from, what his story is, and it's a lot of good stuff. So that one I recommend Googling because, yeah, I can't go over that.
There's a lot of theories for that one.
There's supposed to be another one here in the back. Yes.
I know it was only with the Crisis Core series, but did you research anything about the goddess and how it entails to the Seven series as a whole?
No, I have not. Interesting.
Uh-oh. She's got a thinking face.
I have a thinking face on because I'm trying to go in through the back of my head like, okay, hang on. And again, because here's my thing, I really wanted to make this a panel trying to be as basic of an overview as possible. If I had 3 hours to do this panel, yes, I probably would have gone through that, but I only have an hour.
That's
not
going to
happen. I'll learn my lesson next time. Again, it's 30 pages, it's too much. Yeah, go ahead.
In Final Fantasy X, is there a background to Anemone, the summon?
Yeah. Yes, there is. He does, and he is a mythology. He's a god of death somewhere.
Oh,
somewhere.
Yeah.
Indonesian culture, there we go. Indonesian culture, he's considered the god of death. He's one of the minor gods, like not even a demigod, pretty close to it. But he's an Indonesian culture. That's where he originated from.
What's the name of
Anima. A-N-I-M-A.
Yes, Jesus.
Yeah. You're thinking of that one. Yeah, that's the one.
The chains and the freaky dark world thing.
It's interesting because he actually crosses over into other variations of mythology too, so it's not just one culture. He appears in multiple cultures. That one's the earliest known one that I can find, but he does appear in Christianity, he does appear in Hebrew and stuff like that, so he does pop up.
Mm-hmm.
It was Kazushi Nojima
who confirmed it.
Final Fantasy X-2
Ultimate
Hero. I don't like Nojima.
I don't know. I have here. Okay, here's pet peeve moment. Yay! With the more recent developers from 10 plus, they've been twisting some of the Final Fantasy lore to do some funky, crazy things that don't make it quite Final Fantasy anymore. Because the one thing you have to say about Final Fantasy is that it's not a series. You can't play one and then two is a direct sequel. It doesn't work like that. Each one is its own standalone game. You may have a couple things that cross over, like Chocobos and certain names and such, but for the most part, you're playing a new game with a unique experience. So.
In the number. It,
yeah.
In the number.
In the number. But that's just personal pet peeve. Yes, lady with the beautiful green hair.
What mythology did the as a pawn chair and Atomos come from? I think they're from 13.
Yes, they are. They actually appear in earlier versions. There's a version of Atmos that actually appears in Final Fantasy II, of all things. Those are also very similar. They pop up in multiple religions. You can see them actually in Greek mythology. You can see them in Christianity in some weird stories, in Hebrew. You can see them pop around in so many places.
When you were playing those early cards, were they in Japanese?
Yes.
So you can read Japanese?
I cannot. My friend translated for me.
Good friend.
I have an awesome friend who got many free games.
Is there anything behind Ultras?
I'm sure there is, because that thing is a weird squid. No, actually, I looked up Ultras because he was my first go-to, and he doesn't have anything behind him. He's a unique Final Fantasy character.
God help him.
With tentacles.
He's supposed to be showing up with 14 soon as well.
Oh, of course he is. Why would he not be showing up in 14? It's creepy.
Because everything else is showing up in 14.
Yep.
Yeah.
The Saucer. The Zadinas, the gnomes, do they tie into any mythology?
Which ones?
The gnomes. Zadinas, the race from Final Fantasy 9.
Oh, I did not find anything on that one, because that one was my other go-to thing, too. I thought 9 would be a lot of fun to talk about. I couldn't find anything on those guys. If there is anything online, I'm going to do some more digging, because you guys are popping new things in my head. I'm like, ooh, I should go back and research this stuff. So I'll probably end up adding them to my giant overview of the panel, more than likely. Actually, we're pretty close on time, though. I see one more question. I'm going to get you.
Regarding translation, like, the way it has affected the tone of the game.
Yes.
What's up with Celeste jumping off the cliff?
Oh, God.
Oh, boy.
She's killing herself, right?
Yeah, she is.
But in the American version, she's, like, taking a leap of faith.
You got it right. That's exactly how the American translation is, but yeah, she is committing suicide because of all the things that are happening around her. She just can't take it anymore. She does commit suicide.
And then fails at it.
And fails miserably at it. She wasn't the fourth player character, that's why. She was going to live!
Wait, then how do you explain Saban?
Saban's just special ahead.
Okay.
I say, but that's a good point you bring up about the translations between the Japanese and the English version, because there are a lot of things that get translated over here that are so different and so unique, and words get changed. I mean, Spoony Bard is a fantastic example of that.
Yes!
That was not meant to be Spoony Bard. But interestingly enough, a lot of the concepts, a lot of the character designs, a lot of the thought processes behind the story and the dialogue did translate over pretty well. Because if you look between game to game, even from Final Fantasy I in Japan to Final Fantasy I in the States, it's really, really close. Other than just some weird translation issues, the story is practically the same. So I have to give them credit for doing that right.
Yay!
What's the original from Spoony Bard?
I don't know what the original is. I only know it as Spoony Bard because I think Spoony Bard's funny. Because Tello calls people Spoony Bard. But yeah, that is all I have, guys. Our time is up.